Welcome to Module 9. Today we will concentrate on topology of RN. Of course, we can't cover the entire topic as such, but few glimpses of what is happening inside RN, including R, R2, R3, etc., all together, one single thing. I am not making any separate cases here. Okay, so let us recall that n-dimensional Cartesian coordinate space consists of n tuples of real numbers x1, x2, xn, xi's are inside R. The Euclidean metric, you have denoted by d2 of xy, is nothing but the norm of x minus y, the two norm, which is the square root of the sum of the squares of the differences, xi minus yi. Recall that a closed disk was defined as set of all points which are less than or equal, distance less than or equal to R from a given point, dr of x, so all points in Y, it's a set. Now, I am using this distance, I can drop out this one because for now onwards, unless I mention this, it is always the Euclidean norm. So, I could have done just d of xy, but here I am elaborately writing d2 of xy less than equal to r. Okay. Similarly, the open disk is defined d2 of xy less than r only. Okay. And when that just take the equality, that will be the boundary sphere. It's called a sphere of radius r. Inside everything is at Rn, okay. So it should be n minus one dimensional sphere, all y belonging to Rn, d2 of xy equal to r. So we don't take when r equal to 0, we don't take this as a sphere. So r is positive is important here, okay. The special case when the radius is equal to 1, we will have a separate notation because we have opportunity to use it again and again. So I'll just denote it by dn instead of d10. It's a decorated dn, Euler font. Okay, this is a closed disk of radius 1 centered at 0. Just to indicate that I am working inside Rn, I am putting this n here at the top. Similarly, bn is the open disk. And Sn minus 1 is the sphere of radius 1. Okay, so this is a short notation. So the first thing is that the D2 metric, the Euler, the Euclidean metric, which is coming from the norm, has this obvious property, namely, if you add a vector to both of them, namely x as well as y, D2 of x plus z, comma y plus z is the same thing as D2 of xy. So that is called the invariance of the D2 under translation. The adding z, a constant vector, is called translation. This I denote by tz. Tz is a map from Rn to Rn given by x going to x plus z. Its inverse will be x going to x minus z. And obviously, this continuous map, this is obviously T and T, Tz and Tz inverse, which T minus Z, are inverses of each other, so it is a homeomorphism. Likewise, for each non-zero scalar, you can talk about this MT, multiplication by T, the scalar multiplication, X going to T times X. This time, you have to have T non-zero if you want it to be a homeomorphism. If T is zero, this will take and entire thing to zero, is constant function zero, right? It won't be homeomorphic, that's all. So what is the inverse? Inverse is T going to X going to T inverse X. So if you look at T of Z minus X, okay, maps dr of x, dr of x is center x, subtract x and add z. That will go to into dr z. The radius doesn't change. That is precisely the point here, namely d2 of x plus z, y plus z is d2 of xy. So this ball, this disk, closed disk of radius r, same thing, closed disk radius r, but centers have changed. Okay? So all closed disks with radius r, they are homeomorphic under t z minus x. Similarly, you can fix 1.0 center and multiply the, use the multiplication by arbitrary positive numbers, m s by r here, then you know, dividing by r and multiplying by s, so the radius r will become s. So dr0 is mapped to ds0. And vice versa, you multiply by m r by s, it will be inverse. So dr of x as ds of y, now you can take, they are also homeomorphic to each other because you can compose it, first multiply and then translate and so on. Okay. So the conclusion is that any two open disks are homeomorphic, any two closed disks are homeomorphic, any two spheres are homeomorphic. So first you understand what is going on here. If you put equality everywhere, you will get spheres. Okay. If you put strictly less than strictly less than s, you get everywhere open disks. Less than or equal to, you get closed disks. So argument is the same. Same maps t z minus x and m s by r will work for all of them. Okay. So they are all homeomorphic to each other. Okay. By the way, all these are defined on the entire of Rn. These functions, these homeomorphisms are defined on the entire of Rn. Just to see that this is homeomorphic, this one, we may not need it. There may be many other homeomorphisms. But this is an easy way of seeing that they are homeomorphic to each other. Okay. Now I come to another important one, namely, from the whole of Rn to the open ball of radius 1 centered at 0, I have this homeomorphism. What is it? It's x divided by 1 plus norm x squared. This is again L2 norm I have taken. 1 plus that I have taken. Then I have taken the square root here, raised to half. Okay. You can just directly check that this map here, y going to y divided by 1 minus norm y square raised to half, this is the inverse of that. This map is defined only on the open ball, strictly open ball, because as soon as norm y square is 1, this is not defined. You can't, 1 minus y, norm y square will be 0. Okay, so that indicates that as y approaches the boundary, this map, this value goes to infinity. Okay, so they are not there in the domain. So this is the inverse of that. That is directly you can check. So that will give you that Rn is homeomorphic to B1. You combine it with whatever you have seen here. All open balls are homeomorphic to the whole of Rn. It's very important here that you take R, the open ball, not the closed ball, okay, B10, not D10, okay. So B10 had the notation here, but we have no, we didn't have notation for that, okay. Now I come to different sets. Instead of round spheres and disks and so on, Now I will take squares, rectangles. Okay, all these things I call in general in RN as boxes. So in this terminology, an open interval is a box. Open interval cross open interval is another box. Open interval cross open interval cross open intervals is usual box in R3, but I am using the same word for all n. Okay, so I range from 1 to n, AI comma BI open, these are all open balls, open boxes. Okay, they happen to be open subsets of RN also. Very easy to see, similar to what we have seen. You know, take any ball, take any point inside that, at that point you can give an open ball completely contained inside the original ball, centered this time at the point you have chosen. Similarly, for these open boxes also you can do. Therefore, these are all open subsets first of all. Okay. So what I want to do is that any box like this, any two of them, they are homeomorphic to each other. So first of all, you should check that we have already seen that n equal to 1, any two open intervals are homeomorphic. Remember that. Okay. So you can use that. Several of these AI, BI to say CI, DI here, okay. Then take product of these FIs, which are homeomorphism from AI, BI to CI, DI, that will give you homeomorphism this one. Okay. Yeah. So instead of that, I am going to write one more, namely this is just the way we have done earlier also, namely from minus 1 to plus 1 to AI, BI, you write down this. Fi. Okay, then take F is product of Fi. So if all of them are homeomorphic to this Jn, this another standard notation I'm going to use, namely interval minus 1 plus 1 taken n times, product taken n times. Okay. So if that is homeomorphic to any open interval, any open box like this, any two open boxes themselves will be homeomorphic to each other. Okay. So finally, I want to say that open boxes and open balls, closed boxes and closed balls, they will all be homeomorphic to each other. Okay. So here is a thing here. I should have taken open ball here. I don't have a notation for this one. We have here B1. Yeah. So B10 would have been the right thing here. Okay. Yeah. So I am going to give you a homeomorphism from Jn to Bn0. If you put Dn, it will be only into the interior, because Jn I am taking this as open here. Okay, of course, I am taking usual topology on both sides, the Euclidean topology on both sides. Okay, I want to define a homeomorphism here, but this should be the B10. So we shall do this geometrically, illustrate it by, fine, you can write down a formula also, there is no problem, by using convexity of both the spaces. So this method will be used later on for different things also. Okay. What is the meaning of convexity? Inside any vector space, a subset is called convex. If given any two points inside that subset, t times this vector plus 1 minus t times that vector, which is a line segment. The line segment joining any two vectors, the entire line segment must be inside the subset. That is the meaning of convexity. Okay, I am just recalling it. What we are going to do is use the fact that they are both star-shaped with the apex point at the origin. Star-shaped means little less than convexity. Here, one of the point is fixed, that is called the star. From there, all the lines which are emerging from that point to any of the point of the space of the given set, this entire line segments must be there. Like if you take the union of minus 1 plus 1 open interval along with minus 1 plus 1 on the y-axis, x-axis and y-axis. The whole of x-axis and y-axis union. That is not a convex set, but it is star-shaped at the origin. Okay? So that is star-shaped, definition of star-shaped with apex point at the origin. That means I am writing it down here. Every non-zero element of Dn lies on a unique line segment 0, u, where this u is a unit vector. Okay. So this is the property I am going to use. This property can be stated as star-shaped. If you don't understand this, the property will tell you what I am going to use. So that's enough. Given any point P in Dn, P not equal to 0, P equal to 0 is fine. P not equal to 0, there is a unique line segment. The line segment 0 P will do that. Okay, that's contained inside Dn, because for all these points, the norm will be less than 1. The distance between 0 and that point will be less than 1. So that is the criteria here. Moreover, okay, if every point in x minus, actually every point is x minus t minus 0, that is not equal to 0, lies on a line segment like this, okay, for a unique p belonging to s minus 1, sn minus 1, namely, take p equal to x by norm x, okay? If you take x by norm x, what is the modulus of this? This again, you say 2 norm here, okay? This modulus will be 1. So that is a point of s minus 1. The norm will be 1. So it's a point of s minus 1. Okay. 0 to p will contain this point x, because to come back to x, what you have to do? You have to multiply by its norm of x fact. So here is a picture. Okay, this I am going to use later on. So I will come back to this picture a little later on. Okay, so what I want to do is now the same statement which I did for the sphere, I can do it for the rectangle, the closed rectangle. Okay. Take a point on the boundary of the rectangle, join it to the center. Every point in this, inside this rectangle, other than 0, will actually lie on a unique line like that. So that is the claim. Okay, exactly same way you can do that. For the chain bar, this chain bar is minus 1 to plus 1 raised to n. Okay, that's the closure. This I am taking closed intervals here. If you replace Sn minus 1 by the so-called boundary of Jn, what is the boundary of Jn? You see, in R2, the boundary consists of this line, and that line, right? The four sides. So how do you define that? Here, the x2 coordinate is 0, right? Here, x2 coordinate is 1. Here, the x1 coordinate is 1. Here, x1 coordinate is 0. So that is what you have to do. One of the coordinates is either, sorry, this whole thing I have to take. So this is minus 1 to plus 1, not 0. Okay, this is minus 1 and that is plus 1. So that's what you have to do. So xi is plus 1 or xi minus 1. xi plus minus 1 is 0. Take the product, that is 0, which is same thing as one of them at least must be 0, which is the same thing as xi is plus 1 or xi is minus 1. Okay, that is the boundary of this Jn, the boundary of Jn bar also. Okay, even if you don't know the word boundary in general, doesn't matter. This is the definition here for the boundary of Jn. Notice that Jn can be defined in a different way. All points x belong to Rn such that the maximum norm is less than 1. Okay, this rectangle here in R2 can be defined as, see, minus 1 to plus 1 cross minus 1 to plus 1, or you can just define it as all x comma y such that the maximum of modulus of x modulus of y is less than 1. So that is precisely the maximum norm here. Okay, and Jn bar is all those which is less than or equal to 1. The maximum norm is less than or equal to 1. The boundary is all those in which maximum norm is exactly equal to 1. Okay, at least one coordinate must be exactly equal to 1. I mean modulus of that coordinate. So it could be plus 1 or minus 1. That is precisely what I told you here, how to get this Jn, which I have got it here. Okay, so these are some elementary things, descriptions of some interesting subspaces of Rn. Okay, so one thing which you can observe is the L infinity norm taking the maximum of modulus of x1, x2, xn, or taking the square root of the sum of the squares, etc. Both of these are continuous functions in Rn. What is the meaning of Rn here? With the usual topology. And these are coming into R plus 0 to infinity. So there also I am taking the standard topology. With that, these are continuous functions. Okay, because each modulus of xi is continuous, taking the maximum of continuous, that is what. Here the difference is continuous, taking the square is continuous, taking the sum is continuous, again taking the square root is also continuous because these are non-negative. Okay. Wherever you are taking the square root, the inside thing is a non-negative quantity. So this part is also continuous. Okay. Now comes, look at the fraction here, 1x divided by 1 divided by norm x infinity. Okay, these things are continuous wherever the denominator is not 0. You take a function f which is continuous, 1 by f will be continuous wherever f is not 0. That is the thing I am using here from elementary real analysis. Okay, these are real world functions. Take x going to 1 by norm x infinity or x going to 1 by norm x square. They are continuous on Rn minus 0, because at 0 they are 0, everywhere they are positive. So it follows that the following two formula, eta 1x, which is x divided by norm x square. Now I am multiplying this by x. X is continuous, so multiplication of these two, that will be continuous. Eta 2 similarly is x by norm x square, that is also continuous. So they define continuous functions. Now where are they? I start from the unit sphere, then I take eta 1. Unit sphere means norm of x is 1, the 2 norm of x is 1. But it's L2, it's L infinity norm, maybe something different I have divided it about. That means what? If I take the L infinity norm of this one now, it will be equal to 1. Therefore, it will be in the boundary of Jn. Similarly here, start with anything on the boundary, okay, its L2 norm could be different. So divide by that. Now if you take the L2 norm of this whole thing, it will be equal to 1. So you have landed inside Sn minus 1 here. So these two maps are continuous. Okay, what I want to say is, it's elementary geometrically to see that they are inverses of each other. In fact, take eta 1 of this, okay? Now, what is eta 2 of this one? I have to take whatever here and divide it by its L2 norm, okay? This is some real number. So L2 norm of this is L2 norm of the numerator divided by this number, okay? But what is the L2 norm of this one? See, I want to say that take eta 1 of whatever from starting Sn minus 1. Then apply eta 2 on that one, you come back to Sn minus 1, okay? So you want to say x goes to x, okay? When you divide anything by L2 norm, it will become back to x, because norm of x was already equal to norm of L2 norm of x was already equal to the 1 there here. Okay, so here is the picture, that's what I wanted to say. Picture demonstration of this one. Take a point on the sphere, unit sphere, okay? Extend this line segment so that it hits the boundary of Jn. How do you get that? On this line, you have to take only one element. There's only one element in the same line segment, in same ray, the positive ray, which has its L infinity norm equal to 1. And that is this point. Okay, because there is a unique point which will intersect this one. So x goes to eta 1 x. Now start with this one. If you divide it by its L2 norm, you got back this one, because that is the only point with L2 norm equal to 1. This is the only point. So that is the inverse of that. So eta 2 of this point would have been this one. So this is why eta 2 of that one is this one. Okay. So geometrically, it is very easy to see, but you can do computational laws. Okay, so from the boundary to the boundary, I have a homeomorphism here, because they are inverses of each other. Okay, now what I do, I look at phi 1 from the interior, the entire thing, dn to jn bar. So I define this by formula, phi of tx, remember every point here looks like t times x, where x is a point on the boundary, right? Except when the whole thing is zero, this x will be indeterminate. You could have taken any point. Otherwise, it's a unique point. Everything can be written like this. So x is an Sn minus 1, and I don't want the zero element here. So 0 less than equal to t less than, strictly less than t less than 1. Okay, 0 strictly less than t, less than equal to 1. So this will give you all points other than 0. Those points you take tx divided by the infinite norm, the infinite norm of x. At point 0, I have to define something. So for that, you define it as 0. So it is nothing, this is nothing but, remember, it is eta t times eta 2 of x. So I have defined this one by extending this eta 1, I am extending, I am getting phi 1. Extending how? By putting 0 going to 0. Okay. The problem is that whenever you define it by two different formula, you have to verify the continuity of this. Continuity is now what? Why? Because this is only one point I am worried about. By taking the limit of this as t tends to 0. If the limit is the same point, is the same value here, then the function is continuous. Okay. So that's what I am using here. Elementary calculus. So we need to check the continuity of phi 1 only at the origin. Okay. elsewhere it is given by this formula, which is continuous already. We have seen. So at the origin, so what you want to do, consider sequence TMXM converging to zero. See, XMs are inside SN minus one. They are not fixed. They may be different points. Okay. But TMs are real number. When does this sequence convert to zero? If and only if TM converges to zero. Okay. Because norm of XM is bounded by just one. It's equal to one there. Okay. If bounded sequence, this will be zero only if TM goes to zero. Okay. These are inside SN minus 1. They don't converge to anything. Or they may not converge to anything. They may be converging, if at all, inside SN minus 1. If and only if TM is 0. Therefore, since XM is SN minus 1, this implies norm of XM infinity. You see, this infinite norm of XM is bigger than 1 by square root of n. Okay, there are n points, okay, n coordinates. Each of them is less than 1 by square root of n. The sum total, square of the sum total will be less than 1, right? So at least one of the coordinate must be bigger than or equal to 1 by square root of n. Once one of the coordinate is bigger, the infinite norm will be bigger. So that is all I am using. So the infinite norms are all bounded away from zero. This n is fixed here, by the way. The m is the one which is changing here. The sequence is with respect to the variable m. Okay. And hence, phi 1 of take tm xm or tk xk, okay, doesn't matter, that L2 norm of that, by this definition, it is the L2 norm of tk xk divided by xk norm xk, which this part is bounded by above by 1 by square root of m. So divided by that one will be bounded by less than or equal to square root of n. So it is bounded. Therefore, when t tends to 0, this goes to 0. Okay. Tk over xk by norm infinity. The denominator is what? Is bigger than 1 by square root of n. Therefore, 1 divided by that is less than or equal to square root of n. Exactly similarly, we can define phi 2 as an extension of eta 2 here. Okay. And verify that it's continuous. The same proof will do work there. And it will be inverse of phi 1 all over. Okay. Enjoy writing down the full details here. All right. So this will give you a homeomorphism from square to the circle. Okay. The entire square, including this one, into the days, and then generalize this one. This is the picture for r equal to 2. But generalize this one. I have never used it in this r equal to 2. Only illustration in the diagram. This is there. Okay, so all things, these things are valid for all Rn. All right. We shall later on show that the unit disk in Rn with respect to any norm. Remember, we have several norms here, all these LP norms and so on, right? Is homeomorphic to the unit disk in the Dn means what now? The L2 norm, okay, the Euclidean norm here. They are all homeomorphic to each other, but that will take time. We will do it next time, maybe a little later, not next time. Thank you. There are some exercises here which you can go through by yourself. They will be rewritten to you as they will appear as assignments, and also they will be in the notes, so you don't have to worry about that. So try your hand at all these exercises. Okay, so that's it. Thank you.